Our church is the Highland City Refuge Church of God, and so many times our church has had to be a refuge for people in trouble, people who had needs, people who wanted to be helped by God. And so this morning we're welcoming you to the Highland City Refuge Church of God. Come on in to the refuge. That's where we are. We're here to find refuge, find a place of comfort, find a place to hide like a covert. We're here for the Lord to help us, and we want Him to help you too. I've asked Sister Laney to come sing Shout to the Lord. I felt like it was a good song for this morning.
I want to praise the wonders of your
that so much. Hallelujah. We're going to go to Sunday school now. God bless everybody, and let's go.
Praise the Lord.
To everyone in here and out there, mostly out there. I'm going to keep on talking about hope. And this time, for this lesson, we're going to talk about the endurance of our hope. Or how we can endure the suffering that we have because of our hope in Christ. There's a lot of things going on. Lee and I were talking about this morning how this ministry itself has been an endurance race. I mean, to do a song every day for months and months and months that we've been doing this. And it's hard some days. It's really hard. We're tired. We don't feel well. Our hope is small. But we have our hope in Christ. And we can endure a lot of things when we have that hope. Nobody enjoys pain or conflict or rejection. But these things happen to everybody. Right? There are days where we don't want to do. Well, can't we just skip a day? I mean, we've all said that at one point or another. You know, we're just so tired. But living that life of obedience to Christ can help us get through that. Because we don't face that suffering or that struggle alone. So let me ask a question. When have you needed endurance to complete a task or a goal? I mean, think of a time when you just had to push through. You just had to get it done. You just had to. Yesterday I was putting up a ceiling fan in my office that needed to be replaced, and so I bought a new one, thought, oh, I'll just pop up a new one. It's no big deal. But it was a big deal. It was hard. It was difficult. It didn't need to be, but that's just the way it went. The fan itself was very heavy. I was trying to lift it with one hand and tuck the wires up this other pipe with the other hand and hold the pipe with it. Wait, I only have two hands. And finally, after a couple of hours, I got it. I pushed and the wires went up that pipe, a little hole lined up, and I pushed the fan motor up just enough and went, and I slipped a little pin in there and it was done. But it took endurance. And I remember I had called Sister Lee right before that. I said, I don't know if I can get this thing up there. may just have some wires hanging from the ceiling for a while, because it will not go up there. And she goes, well, can Lainey help you? Or, you know, when I get home, I'll help you. Or I was like, well, there's one ladder, and it's 6 feet up in the air, and it's... But I said, I'm going to just take a rest, and then when I go back, I'm going to... And when I was laying there resting, I said, Lord, you just got to help me get this ceiling fan up. And he did. The very next try was successful. And there's others where, you know, maybe, you know, you have a project, or you have, or maybe it's something in a personal matter or a relationship that you want to have fixed or at least under control. And sometimes we need endurance to get that, to have that success or to complete those things. But through that whole time, when we need that endurance because of our suffering or our pain or our conflict, we don't face it alone when we have Christ. Christ is with us. And the idea is, when we show that we have that faith and we have that endurance of our hope, other people see it. And then they can have it. They know that it's available to them. We turn to 1 Peter chapter 3. And again, Peter is writing this to Asia Minor, and those folks are being persecuted. And over he points to their hope in Christ as a motivation to stay faithful to God and to Jesus Christ. And he talks about, in chapter 3, he starts talking a little bit more about how Christians should live. So verse 8 says, finally, being ye all of one mind, having compassion one of another, love as brethren, be pitiful, be courteous, not rendering evil for evil or railing for railing, but contrariwise, blessing, knowing that ye are thereunto called, that ye should inherit a blessing. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil, and his lips that they speak no guile. Let him eschew evil and do good. Let him seek peace and ensue it. For the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. He's talking about blessing. He wants us to call on God to grant his grace. Or he wants us to receive grace from God. And Peter's talking about them, first of all, being of one mind, or thinking alike. He wasn't trying to get a full uniformity across all of Asia Minor. That wasn't going to happen. But at least agreement on the core principles or their core doctrines of Christianity, they needed to be instilled in their hearts completely. And part of that, when that was instilled in their hearts, was that then they could conduct themselves both when they're in the church setting, but also conduct themselves as Christians when they're outside of the church setting. There are a lot of people that are great people in church. They're not so great people outside of church. Peter wanted them to be of one mind. Not just one mind for this second, but one mind all the time. The devil will try to divide. And he does a lot of damage among believers by creating division. within the beliefs. So having that one mind and having compassion one of another. That word compassion literally means to feel with someone. It's where we get our word sympathy. The Greek word is sympathos. And it's how we respond when we have a feeling with someone else, when we understand how. All right, I'll try this one. When we understand how they feel, how they are being challenged, either through an experience that we had similar, or just having empathy toward them. Romans 12 and 15 says, "Rejoice with them that do rejoice, and weep with them that weep." Right? To feel with someone, to have compassion one of another. And it says, love as brethren, or love your brother, basically. And he uses that word philadelphios, which is brotherly love, or unfeigned love. And that kind of love, that the love that we have for fellow brothers and sisters in Christ, should be the rule and not the exception.
Right.
Right. Even when they aren't nice to us, even when they don't believe maybe exactly the way we do, we're called as Christians to love them with brotherly love. Then the word pitiful he uses, and it's sometimes translated tender-hearted. In the Psalm 95, it says, harden not your heart, which was implying don't have a stubborn or a harsh attitude or a mindset. Don't make your heart hard, right? Soften it. Be tender-hearted. Be pitiful. Not pitiful as in, you know, I'm pitiful. What's the good one?
Having pity.
Having pity, or just... but tender-hearted. So the same way that we're to, lost my page, have compassion on one another and really feel with someone, he also wants us to be tender-hearted toward them and not to harden our heart.
Right.
And then the last descriptive word he uses there, and he uses five descriptive words just in verse 8, be courteous, friendly, kind. Don't be abrasive, abusive. Being courteous intertwines itself with considering other people to be more important than yourself.
Right. That's so true.
So Peter talks about these five traits, and then he goes on further, and he said that we should also respond to evil acts and words in a kind way, not with evil. It says, not rendering evil for evil or railing for railing, but contrariwise blessing. Rather than making a habit of returning the hurt. Right? A lot of us, if somebody rails on us, we rail back at them. I have an example.
Amen.
It was one, I was out and we went up to this gentleman. He was irritated that we were there, and he let us know about it. He,
yip.
I can't go into what he said because that's not right. It was pretty abrasive. It was pretty abusive. And I was with another gentleman who I didn't really know. I just met him that day. And I was just like, you know, okay, well, we'll just go back here and we'll be fine. And I was going to get out of Marianne's way because he was obviously, he didn't want us there. And the other man just railed right back on the first man. And I'm like, this isn't going to get us anywhere. This isn't going to get us anywhere. We have to be able to be kind even when people are not so kind to us. We have to avoid responding to evil acts and words with the same type of evil behavior. That's not what Christ wants for us. In the Old Testament, it talks about an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. And Jesus told his disciples in Matthew chapter 5 to abandon that way, to not recompense that way. Paul said, recompense to no man evil for evil. And that as believers, we should make a habit of blessing other people more than rebuking them.
Come on, help me, Lord.
We should love our enemies. We should pray for our persecutors. We should forgive those who have hurt us. It's hard. It's hard to turn the other cheek. It's hard to just accept railing and give back blessing. It's hard. I'm not saying any of this is easy, folks. It's hard. But Peter talks about if we offer a blessing, then we inherit a blessing. Well, we can take that situation, that evil intent, and dispense a blessing to it, then God will let us inherit a blessing from it. As disciples, we're called to be a blessing-giving people. And that as believers, we should be worthy of our calling. Now, Peter and Paul weren't saying that we had to be perfect. They knew better. They knew we're not going to be perfect. We're not going to be able to live perfectly by God's standards. That comes into what we talked about a few weeks ago, about if we try to keep the letter of the law in every aspect. It's impossible. Except for Christ, it's impossible. But what they were saying was that we should demonstrate the evidence of our salvation by the way that we live and the way that we react to those situations of hostility toward us, by giving a blessing to others.
I remember years ago, someone had done me, as a young, preteen, someone had done me really wrong, terribly wrong. And I told Mama what happened, and she said that she would handle it. And she baked the person a pie and took it to them, and they were aware that she was forgiving of them, and she was, you know, and it was an example, a very predominant example in my life of when someone slaps you in one side of your cheek, you turn the cheek and you go back and you do good to those who do evil. It was a hard lesson for me because I wanted, you know, that person to be told off, or, but in the end, the Lord used that to teach me that that is what we should do, is we turn the other cheek, we give kindness, and we pray for them that despitefully use us.
And it's counterculture to the world.
Oh, like, totally.
I mean, if somebody yells at me, I yell right back at them.
Well,
that's what I don't. But that's what the world teaches, right? I mean, that's what the world is about. It's very hard to stay silent when somebody's railing on you.
Right.
It's a hard thing. It's an effort. It's an endurance.
Right.
It's an endurance. And we can endure that suffering because of our hope in Christ. Peter wanted his readers to constantly display Christ-like behavior, even in their trials. And remember, the people in Asia Minor, there about 5% of them were Christians. 95% of them were pagan, God-worshipping peoples, or not worshipping anything. So they were in the great minority, and they were being railed upon. They were being condemned, chastised, abused, persecuted, terribly. And Peter kind of quotes another scripture. Turn to Psalm 34. Psalm 34, I'm going to start at verse 12. What man is he that desireth life and loveth many days, that he may see good? Keep thy tongue from evil and thy lips from speaking guile. Depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open unto their cry. The face of the Lord is against them that do evil, to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth. So that's the scripture that Peter is re-quoting here. Verses really 10 through 12. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil, that his lips may speak no guile. So the quality, Peter was trying to get them to understand that because of Jesus' victory over death, the quality, the true quality of our lives depends on those eternal blessings from God.
Right.
And we inherit those when we bless someone else. There's no guarantee that a Christian will live a long and happy life in this world. I mean, in fact, the Bible tells us that we will experience persecutions and suffering in this life because of how we believe. But that's only for this life. Right? The real blessing, the real endurance comes in for that eternal life, the life after this life. And Peter's trying to give them guidance on how to exchange their fears of what man may do to them and exchange it for a fear in the Lord. But not fear like in be afraid, but fear as in reverence him. And he was trying to guard them against speaking words that were evil or full of deceit. And then in verse 11, he says, reject every kind of evil and replace it with good. Not just morally good, but a lifestyle that is attractive to the people that see it. There are a lot of people that see how we work and how we live and how we interact with other people and how we help other people, how we pray for other people, how we, whatever it is. And they're watching that. People in your families are watching that. People in your workplaces are watching that. And they want to know, with everything crazy that's going on in this world, how is Sister Lee just calm and content? How is Sister Tammy just taking it all in and taking it in stride. How is Brother Don able to not just absolutely melt down and sob openly? I got a laugh from him, right?
Are you done with your water?
Oh, no. I was waiting to take a drink.
Really?
It would taste and see. But how can we continue to do that? And people notice that. I had another example. Again, I have a lot of examples. I was golfing, and I hit a most horrible shot. Horrible. And then, so I teed up another ball, and I hit another shot. Equally as horrible as the first. Terrible. Not even close. I teed up a third ball, and I got that one, and I hit it decent enough. So I went to get into the golf cart, and the gentleman that was with me that I just met that day, this was the very first tee, and he says, "You're a Christian, aren't you?" I said, "Yes, sir." He says, "Because I would have said a lot of bad words if that happened to me," is what he said. And I didn't. I didn't say it. I might have thought a couple, but I didn't say anything. But people notice. They're looking at us. They're observing. And Peter was calling them to seek peace and ensue it. The biggest thing he wanted them to do was be intentional about avoiding confrontation. Being intentional about avoiding contentious behavior. We don't have to be contending with everybody in our path.
Come on. Help me, Lord.
The Bible says, make peace with all men.
Come on. Live at peace.
And remember that God is always watching over the righteous. He is listening to our prayers. But also says the contrary wise, it says, but he also turns his face from those that do evil.
Right.
He's not going to pay attention to them that do evil. So how do these teachings that Peter's trying to get across to them, how do they compare or contrast with the values in our earthly culture? I don't think they line up very well.
No.
Right? I mean, these almost stand out as radical behavior in today's culture. I mean, it's kind of funny to say that being peaceful and peaceable is radical. But it's certainly contrary are completely different than the values that our culture has overall. I mean, if someone, you know, does something to you, I would not have baked him a pie. I would have made it so they wouldn't be able to eat pie for a month. That's the old me. There's times when rage can build up in a person.
Right.
But we can endure our suffering because of our hope in Christ.
Don't you think that the more that you love Jesus, the more you're able to do that? I mean, the more things become less overwhelming that you can't forgive or you can't overlook or you can't yell. Listen, I'm hoping because I'm 25 years and the little things still get me. And I still have to apologize for losing my temper or for saying something smart alecky or, you know,
to me, the
drive-through people that get me.
The people closer.
the telephone.
Telephone to
customer service.
Support people. No, to me, the longer or the closer I got to Christ, the less those little things bothered me. And matter of fact, the little things become almost comical. You're like, really? You keep really say that? That's just ridiculous. That's not even true. And it doesn't bother you when you're associated with the one that can carry us through, right?
But it's not instantaneous. And if you are at the place where, I mean, it almost sounds trite to say it's just a lot easier. Because the truth is that all of us, in different ways, face things that are very difficult to have victory through with other people. I mean, that's just the truth. And
right.
And when that happens, it's how we handle it, even if we don't handle it well, that each time we try to handle it better than we did the time before. It may not be full victory. Oh, that was easy. No problem. I didn't have to fight with that. No, there are going to be some things in our past or in our lives or in with interpersonally because people are annoying or whatever, or we're annoying, that we're going to have to just try each time that we face it to have a little more victory. It's a little step here and there. It's not always just, I'm over the top since I'm saved. It's absolutely easy for me to just turn the other cheek. It still isn't 25 years down the road with me for some things. And I have to rage a little bit about it and then go and say I'm sorry, right?
No.
Brother Don? But the Lord, each time, if I keep my mind on the Lord, and when I mess up, I say, or when I have resentment, or when there's, you know, I haven't handled it right, or I have unforgiveness in my heart, if I take that to the Lord, each time, it's going to get better, right?
To walk the talk.
Right.
Right? How do I, you know, we read these things, and we hear what Peter's saying, But do we walk that?
Well, and it's just knowing that there's some things that aren't just easy to overcome.
Right.
I mean, we get messages from people every day about things that they don't know how they'll ever get past. And so we have to realize that everyone faces things that may not be easy to just turn the other cheek and roll on. But then if we're willing to give the Lord as much as we can of that every time we face it, or live as much victory as we can in it, and move a step forward instead of a step back. I'm just going to have this bitterness. I'm just going to hold on to this hatred. I'm just going to rage.
But wait, does Christ want you to do that? Any of that? Hold on to any of that?
No, but the truth is that Don, we can say, hey, we just give that up and it's no big deal. But there are things that are very difficult. I think of someone right now that it took you years to forgive, right? And it's not, I mean, well, and that's what I'm saying. There's still things, if you think about it.
I have.
Right, if you think about it and you think, oh, that person really did
me
wrong.
Then all of a sudden that stirs back up again.
Right, and then you have to put it back under the blood. But the truth is this, is that not everything is instantaneous in your walk.
No, never.
It's just not. And so we can't get discouraged when we get in a disagreement with somebody and handle it wrong. We make it right. We ask the Lord to forgive us. We try to forgive the other person or try to forgive ourselves.
And the time frame that we're doing that, we are going to endure.
Right. And that,
right.
I guess that's what I'm saying too. It's not an instantaneous.
Instantaneous.
It's finding endurance even when we're failing miserably at trying to be kind or forgiving or loving or gentle.
So Peter talks about there's six things. One is unity. He talked about being of one mind. Right? Unity on the major points of faith. Not necessarily the little things. There's always going to be little differences of opinion about this, that, or the other, right? But the core essential elements, we have to be unified. Then the other is mutual concern. We have to have compassion or sympathy. We have to feel what others feel. Kind of suffer together with some of that. And then employing love, that brotherly love, responsibility to love one another as brothers and sisters in Christ. Number four is compassion. The church should be a place of compassion where we, if we're going to make an error, we're going to err on the side of grace. We're going to do too much rather than not enough.
Yes.
And then humility. We have to have a realistic impression of ourselves. We have to measure ourselves by Christ's holiness. There's no room for pride. And then the last one is forgiveness. An unforgiving spirit will disrupt your fellowship with Christ. The roots of bitterness will sink deep into your heart and make it more difficult for you to love Christ, because that's going to harden your heart. It's not going to keep you tender-hearted.
Right.
And we'll go back to some of what Sister Lee said. Yeah, well, what if, you know, all these people are doing things? It says in verse 13, "And who is he that will harm you if ye be followers of that which is good? But, and if ye suffer for righteousness' sake, happy are ye, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled." That righteousness allows us to conduct ourselves in ways that please and honor God. It's the assurance that God is always watching. And what Peter is combining here is, he's combining a thought with, and asking the people, who would harm them? Who could harm them if they were faithfully obeying the commands of God? I mean, if I'm living in the right relationship with God and he's watching over me all the time, then who can harm me? He was saying, as long as that we are good and in right relationship with God, he wasn't saying that they wouldn't be attacked, because they will, right? They're going to be attacked by Satan or by non-believers. I mean, Jesus and Paul taught over and over that just because you're in a right relationship with God doesn't make you immune to pain or persecution. But what Peter's saying is that our good conduct may convince those people that don't know Christ to at least respect us enough not to persecute us. I mean, Satan will attack believers in any variety of ways, over and over again. And God always stands through us during the trials. In Romans 8, he talks about how nothing can separate us from the love of God. But the struggles are real. The things and the conflicts and the persecutions are real. They happen.
Yes, they do.
We were talking this morning about how the devil has taken every person in our ministry and attacking them in different ways. And we have to endure it. because we're doing the right things. We are suffering for righteousness' sake. I did it that time. And Peter was telling them that they are blessed when they're in that suffering. Happy are ye. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm not real happy when I'm suffering. I'm a little grumpy. I got to laugh for a moment. I'm not normally grumpy. She knows when I'm over my limit, though. She can tell that I will act badly. Not terrible.
No.
Just not my normal self. She can tell when I've had enough or when it's just too much. But I'm learning that I can endure these things. And normally it doesn't last very long.
How many years do you have in, brother?
18.
Right. So 18 years, I mean, you think about, of course, your personality is a little kinder maybe than most. Not just because you're my husband, but you're really pretty even keel versus me, who's over the top, it seems, almost every day in something. And so if you've got 18 years in, the person who's got, I don't know, 6 years may not be the same place as far as getting that endurance and that temperament of gentleness or forgiveness or endurance of turning the other cheek. I mean, a lot, sometimes it's really, it's gaining ground each day,
right?
Each year.
Well, and I think you grow in your endurance or your ability to endure.
Right.
You also grow in your spiritual maturity. I think I've grown greatly in my spiritual maturity over those years. It's not something that's instantaneous. Peter talks about putting away our fear. Be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled. So he was talking that he was challenging them not to be afraid of those people who acted in evil ways toward them.
But let me ask this, Brother Don. Should we be a doormat?
Oh, no.
Do you think that Jesus was a doormat?
Absolutely not.
Do you think that Paul was a doormat?
No, I mean, and nor was Peter, because he talked about, where is it?
Well, I think about, while you're finding that, I think about Paul, who they were beating him, and, you know, he'd gotten beaten, and when the main centurion went to go lead him out, and he's like, so, you think it's all right that they just beat us, Roman citizens? And the guy's like, what? You're a Roman, and we just beat you without permission or a trial or anything? And he went and told his leader and said, hey, you need to take care of what you're doing. These guys are Romans. Paul didn't just say, here, come and beat me because I'm a Christian. He's like, so, you want to? And they put him in jail, and then they said, okay, you can leave. And Paul said, you come and you tell them to come get me out. They put me in here. Come get me out. They put me in here illegally. They should be the ones to release me. He didn't just back down.
Right.
I don't think we go on some big crusade to be crazy about things, but there's things you stand up for. You're not a doormat. Paul's like, you come get me out. You beat me illegally.
Right. Well, and it's not, they don't want to, like in this verse where it says, you know, who is he that will harm you? You're not saying that you should stay in an abusive relationship or anything like that. Right? I mean, you have to be able to fight for your rights. But as long as you're doing it with Christian zeal and not anger or not hostility.
Right. I don't think Paul was mad. He was just like, you did wrong, and I'm going to hold you accountable.
Right.
But it wasn't hateful. It was just, I'm standing up for the fact that I'm a Roman. I'm a Roman Christian, and you are going to have to do what's right by me.
Paul knew also that he was going to do other things. Christ had told him that he was going to do other things.
I'm not going to be stuck in this jail. I'm not going to be killed.
Right, I'm not going to be killed in this jail because I know the Lord has told me I'm supposed to go here and there and somewhere else, and I'm not done yet.
Well, and I always go back to Jesus being righteously angry and taking the cords and kicking people out of the temple. I don't think that he was hateful to those people. But I do think that he was standing up for his Father's house. And at some point, as a Christian, Sister Linda made that person a pie. She could have taken them to the law. She could have. It was illegal. But and maybe she should have. But the truth is she gave me an example of when someone does you wrong, that the Lord's way is to turn the other cheek. Now, sometimes you've got to take somebody to the law. Sometimes you've got to, to stand up. And that's, I guess, what happens is the more you know the Lord, the more you feel that you can go to the Lord and say, listen, at what point do I say enough's enough? I'm not going to be around this person anymore. Or I'm not going to hold on to this anymore. You know, I guess it's a balance of not being a doormat, but being humble and having humility. That's part of the endurance, isn't it?
Well, and that ability to carry us through those difficult circumstances.
To figure it out.
And how do we, we're going to have times where we have unjust suffering.
Of course.
And a lot of it's due to the fact that we're standing up for what's right. What Peter's trying to say is that if our hope is rooted in Christ, then we can endure through those undeserved trials.
Right?
Because who is he that will harm you if ye be followers of that which is good?
Well, it's like we have a couple of people in our church who have COVID. Right. Did they do something to deserve that? No. And we're under attack from the enemy. But the truth is that we can endure through those trials. We cannot be discouraged.
And sometimes those trials are for a purpose, right? The disciples asked Jesus, you know, who sinned that made this man blind? His parents? Himself?
Right.
And Jesus said, neither.
Right.
And so the glory of God can be made manifest. So I can prove a point to someone altogether different, thousands of years later. Right, reading this story or scripture in the Bible, and I can touch somebody's heart. And verse 15 says, "But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear, having good conscience that whereas ye speak evil of you as of evildoers, they may be ashamed that falsely accuse your good conversation in Christ. For it is better, if the will of God be so, that ye suffer for well-doing than for evil-doing."
Right.
Sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. Right? Set apart your heart for God. And be ready to give an answer of the hope in which we trust. The word answer there is actually translated, our word apology comes from that.
Apologia?
Apologia is the Greek word. But Peter wasn't using it in that sense. He was talking more about apologetics, which is a systematic argumentative discourse or a defense. He wasn't calling in believers to argue with a non-believer. What he was trying to do was have that believer be able to explain the hope that was theirs in Christ to that person that was not a believer. And when we start to do that, when we can really explain our hope in Christ and be ready to give an answer, there's a security, there's a satisfaction that we have that is both priceless and eternal in value. It's what we talked about the other night, the lively hope that we have, the hope that has lasting meaning, that endures. But sometimes a person is just looking for a simple explanation of what we believe and why we believe that. Particularly new Christians. Well, I understand that you believe in Christ and the big things, but what about this thing? What about that thing? Not everybody believes that way. Where does our hope come from? Are we ready to give an answer for what we believe? Then Peter talks about always, right? Being always ready to share the gospel, always ready to explain our hope. Always ready to accept the assignment that God has for us in His plan as a priority. Then the other phrase he uses, to every man that asketh you. In today's world in particular, a person's worth is a lot of times defined by external values and appearances. People will understand or accept or reject based on those values and appearances that they see from you. I guess, would a Christian slave be willing to share the gospel with a slave owner? Would a Jewish believer be prepared to share his beliefs with a Gentile in the first century? Somebody from a totally heathen background? And Peter talks about how they're to share their hope, to give an answer and a reason with meekness, fear, and a good conscience. A person that can do that has an accurate understanding of himself or herself in relation to God. He's not consumed with self-importance. She's not unable to relate to other people, right? She can relate with other people because of her humility and kindness and courtesy that she expresses to others because of the love of Christ, because of the indwelling of the Holy Ghost. And then the last section of this, he wanted them, and then really throughout the whole letter of 1 Peter, he wants them to be full of hope as they endure persecution for Christ's sake. He talks about, in verse 17, he talks about that suffering being the will of God. A lot of people don't believe that. But God allows suffering. It's instructed in the Bible that Christians will have persecution and trials and tribulations. And so that we'll not be so self-reliant on ourselves, and we'll be totally dependent on Him to see us through. The suffering for a Christian is under God's control. We have to remember that. Regardless of how absolutely spiraling and out of control it looks like, He is in control.
Right. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
He permits it to happen, and He will give us the strength to endure it. He gives us the endurance. And he kind of concludes this by saying, it's better that ye suffer for well-doing than for evil-doing. You have consequences because of an evil behavior or an evil act or an act of disobedience. It's better that you would suffer for doing good things, being a Christ follower. If you're having persecutions because of the way you believe in Jesus Christ, then you suffer for well-doing. It is better that ye suffer for well-doing than for evil-doing. Believers are called to live holy lives. And when we do, our enemies won't have any basis for accusations or attacks or any such thing. Right? God's in control of it because He helps us do this. And then the first way He's going to help us do this is we have to surrender. We have to see our life and our circumstances from God's perspective. And when we acknowledge that He is the Lord of our life and not us, then we can surrender ourselves to Him and let Him take care of our suffering. The second thing is to bless. If someone has treated you like an enemy or maybe you've treated someone that way, seek to bless that person with love and compassion and humility. It's hard. When they've wronged you, it's hard. But that's what Christ wants us to do. And the third is defend. Ask the Lord for opportunities to display and defend the hope that is in you, that you have for Him. And when the Lord opens that door for you to tell someone else or to share that, be ready. Right? What did it say? Be ready to give an answer of the hope. Right? Give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. Right? Be prepared. Be ready to verbally tell that person what it means to have your hope in Christ. Amen?
Yeah, thanks. Amen, amen, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Watching both day and night, I'm getting ready to leave. Lord for all he's doing. We're still, this service, we're still quarantined from everyone except our family that's been with us. And Brother Jose is much, much better. And he's going to be retested. And so we were hoping that maybe he could be yesterday so we could be together. But, right, we have a lot of prayer requests about some people who have, that are dear to us, that have COVID. So we went to, into Sunday school, we prayed a little bit, but we're going to take them before the Lord right now. Please remember Brother Jose, who's fighting that. Remember our dear Brother Henson, who's in the hospital, not with COVID, but with other issues. Pray for him. And Sister Alice and Sister Barbara and Brother Kevin's family that are facing COVID, and their daughter Alyssa, and just remember them, that the Lord would protect the ones that don't have it. Our dear Sister Cherie from Augusta is very, very sick with COVID and needs the Lord to move and heal and deliver her. And also in Augusta, Sister Tammy's neighbor, Brother Freddie, he needs the Lord to move and deliver him. Please pray for him, that the Lord would, he is in, I don't know that he's in ICU, but he is in ICU, and he requires breathing support. And please remember his sister and his mother, Sister Loretta, that came to church with us when we were in Augusta, and she's been battling with some seizures she asked prayer for, so please remember Loretta too. And remember Elon and Tina and the Roberts family. Remember Judy, that we've been praying for, as she seems to be passing away. Anybody else that has something that I know that we've got. Remember Sherry Stout, they've had a death in their family, that the Lord would help them. And so please remember. That's from our Facebook extended church family. Remember all of our Facebook and YouTube extended family, church family.
Little Nevaeh from Sister Sharon's great-grandbaby.
Sister Sharon's great-grandbaby, Nevaeh, was needing breathing help today. Somebody else.
Bob Fizzer.
Yes, Bob Fizzer, he would completely recover. Anybody else have something?
Remember our neighbors, that yes. God will save them. And
neighbors.
Everybody.
Remember Bill, he's fighting, not feeling well today. And he's been struggling. Just ask the Lord to heal him completely. He had that surgery that should have fixed some things, but it seems like it's just really not getting better with the congestion, and he's just miserable. So please remember Bill, that the Lord would help him. It's hard because, of course, during the season of COVID, everyone is worried if you're congested that you've got something, but Bill just has a chronic sinus issue, so please remember him. Anything else? Please remember our ministry, that the Lord would let it go forth and be just what it wants, it needs to be, without hindrance. Don's starting his new job tomorrow. And Lori starts a new school tomorrow. Please pray for her. And just remember all of us. All right, if you haven't spoken, take those to the Lord too. And we'll go to prayer right now.
Thank you, Jesus. God, pray.
Crazy kids to be. He's born to fly. healing, the deliverance, the power.
Amen. Oh, hallelujah.
glory, glory,
glory, glory, glory, glory.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. I have renewed living on higher ground. Page 94. I'm living at work. Will I have left that town before?
I'm laid aside that heavy load.
The way of life.
Sister Lee to give her testimony this morning before I preach, so I want her to come and do that.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for all the music, musicians. Appreciate you.
Last night we were seeking the Lord. The enemy has really seemingly attacked, and we just noticed that a lot of people, it seems like, you know, our church is fighting COVID. And not terrible cases in Jose's, but in the Rooks family, it's been really terrible. And then other people that we know of that have been touched by our ministry. And so last night I felt like I am sick of this. I'm sick of feeling under attack about this. And I want to pray until I feel some victory.
Go ahead.
And so I called Mama. Mom and I were talking, and we started really praying, and the Holy Ghost started really moving in me and just speaking and speaking and speaking and speaking. I'll have some kind of thought of what maybe the Lord was saying and their words, but last night, it was really just an image. And above me, I could see just a battle waging. And it was huge. It was this real dark form. And then this four other forms of light that were fighting. I mean, it was pretty stereotypical, I guess, of what people have said about spiritual warfare. But I haven't really ever delved in that a lot. I agree with the scriptures about what they say, but I just have never really thought of it a lot. And last night as we were praying, and I started thinking about where the scripture says in Ephesians 6 and 12, it talks about, let me find it, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." I really started believing and knowing that this ministry that we started just, we thought on our own idea that I would send a song to one person. And then COVID started and we began sharing these services because we had to go remote because of COVID. And so we started sharing that, and it was almost, it seemed like just chance, which it wasn't. It was designed. But we didn't really understand the designing of it. And this week, we have gotten very detailed emails from people saying how this ministry has just made a great difference in their lives.
Amen.
And it's farther reaching than we could have ever imagined. And it's really humbling. When I speak of it, I don't feel this, oh, it's me. Because no, I feel so humbled that Jesus Christ would come and just work through me.
Yes,
and through our church, our little church that's maybe had 25 or 30 people total, the most that we've ever had maybe, and sometimes 15 and sometimes 10, and when we started it was 3 or 4. But that would be going forth to people and helping them is miraculous. But the miracle of it has made the devil mad. He's angry. And if you've been affected by our ministry, you're probably being affected by the fight. And if you're being affected by the fight, I want to say to you that after they talked about wrestling against flesh and blood and against principalities, interesting to me is I've always just taken that word and, not thought about it. But a principality is a place where a prince owns, or where there's a royalty that owns this part, or it's part of his belonging. And the prince of this air, the devil, is trying to keep what ground he's losing.
Right.
And
we don't know
where this has gone forth. We know it's been on every continent of the world. We know that we know of every continent we've seen where people have seen this ministry. And I just say that the devil is angry.
Right.
And you know what? Oh, I don't care that you're mad, Satan, you're a liar. We're not wrestling against each other. We're not wrestling against COVID and the sickness of that. We're wrestling against fighting to take back things from the devil that he thinks he owns. And he doesn't own everything above us and that property beneath him. He does not own these vessels that have been saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, that are being drawn to be saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. The devil doesn't own that anymore in the name of Jesus. And the way we're going to fight that, "Wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God." If you're fighting and you're battling because you've been affected by this ministry and you started laying aside things that you knew the Lord has shown you to do, and you started being willing to surrender your whole heart and your whole mind to Jesus Christ, and all of a sudden it's like just your whole world is exploding into trouble. I'll tell you what's happening. It's not because that you've got such victory and you're saved and it didn't work. It's not because salvation didn't do a work in you. It's not because sanctification isn't doing the work in you. It's not because the Holy Ghost drawing you to be living in your inside. It's not because of that. It's because the devil is angry and he wants to take back what he had.
Amen. He wants to take back the property that he owned before this ministry started ministering to you. And he can't do it.
No.
Because the Lord sent us here, placed us here 31 years ago, and began training us how to endure, right. Brother Don. How to keep going when there's two people in the seats. How to keep going when five or six leave after a pastor appreciation because they feel led to go somewhere else. Now, that's tough. We've had to endure. We've had to endure whenever we've been out in the tent with flies and heat and because we're tiny and the Lord hadn't said to go anywhere else or do anything else. We've endured some hardship. We've endured some scorn because we're so little or because we have a woman pastor it and because we have things that have happened in the past. We've endured scorn. We've not had big openings for our music to go forth until this time.
Amen.
For such a time as this. And I'll tell you what, the Lord was teaching us to hold out.
Right. He
was. And we're going to hold out because the enemy may be mad, but he can fight. He can start fighting the foes in heaven. But I'll tell you, I know who wins.
Right.
The Bible shows us who wins. I think about it in Daniel. Daniel was fasting and praying for 21 days and he couldn't get an answer. I don't know, maybe you've been sick for 21 days. Maybe you've been discouraged and depressed for 21 days. Maybe you've had something bad happen. You got saved or you got encouraged by our ministry and decided I'm going to live for Jesus strong. And then all of a sudden it just blew out and you're under your feet, you feel like you're falling to the ground and you have no hope and you sat there for 21 days. But let me tell you something, friend. What happened when the angel got to, Michael got to Daniel, that angel said, I was hindered. For 21 days, I was fighting the prince of Persia. He was angry that Daniel was taking some of his property. And the prince of Persia, we believe, was in the air. Some devil that owned some property that must affect the people that lived on it and all of its land. And let me tell you, you might be fighting the prince of Persia or the prince of Greece. You may have done it for 21 days and you feel like God's nowhere to be found, friend.
Oh my.
But that day Daniel found out that Michael, the very archangel of God, was fighting for him get that message to him. Most beloved Daniel.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, glory.
Yes, I want to read that where it says, Then said he unto me, and he said, verse 11, chapter 10, verse 11 of Daniel. And he said unto me, O Daniel, a man greatly beloved,
yes,
understand the words that I speak unto thee and stand upright, for unto thee am I now sent. And when he had spoken the word unto me, I stood trembling. What a humble man Daniel was. Then he said unto me, fear not, Daniel. For from the first day that thou didst set thine heart to understand and to chasten thyself before thy God, thy words were heard, and I am come for thy words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. But lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. Now I am come to make thee understand what shall befall thy people in the latter days, for yet the vision is for many days. So the Lord sent someone from that battle where Michael was battling and had battled it and helped that angel. I said it was Michael, but it was another angel that came to tell Daniel, here's the message you needed to hear. Here's the thing that you have struggled with for lo these days. The devil may say to you, where is your God now? You repented. You tried to make things right. You've tried to live closer to God. You've tried to get help. You've tried to be more righteous. Where is your God now that you're sick with COVID or that you're discouraged or that your family member died? Where is your God now? You look at that devil and you tell him, my God's fighting for me. My God is fighting for me. He is delivering me. My God is making a way where there's not been a way. My God is making things come to pass. It may be that there's 21 days that I've waited. Maybe I've waited 6 months. Maybe I've waited 8 or 10 months. Maybe I've had to wait. But let me tell you, friend, my God is fighting this battle for you.
Right, amen.
That's what he showed me. He showed me that the angels and this dark force were fighting over us.
Go ahead, sister.
And I'll tell you what. I'd rather be waiting on a God that's able.
Woo! Go ahead.
Than sitting down here saying he's left me alone when those forces up there are fighting as hard as they can for victory in us. And I'm going to wait it out if I have to. I may not be able to have the victory I thought I could have, but every single day sometimes, but I can wait. Daniel fasted and prayed and he waited on God. And when he stood up, that angel said, I've been fighting with Michael, the very archangel of God, to get this message to you. And I believe, I really know that this ministry, the way that it has gone forth, the absolute way that people all over the planet have heard us sing, have heard us ministry, or minister, have heard our services, that the enemy is not happy about that. And when I say it, most of you that know me know that that's not pride speaking. I am not bragging that our little teeny tiny church with very real, sometimes very flawed people, you see them. And I'm not bragging on me or my mama, my husband, or my children. If you look behind the cameras, you'll see some days we have to repent. You'll see some times we have to pray through. That's just the truth, because we're real. But I'll tell you this. I'm going to brag on my God.
Right.
Because God took this little tiny thing and went and blew it to all the corners of the earth and said, I'm going to reach and pull for people who are willing to come my way. And the ones of you that are out there and are in here that are willing to come that way, I want to tell you something, friend. You're going to have to fight. So put on the whole armor of God. Get up and fight. Realize that the devil wants to destroy us. He wants to take back all the ground that he's lost from us being in victory.
Right.
Realize it. Stop thinking that it's just me and I don't have enough victory. I don't have what I need. It's just me. No, some things that you're facing are absolutely an attack from the devil. Now, if you're living in sin, stop. You're not going to have victory if you're living in sin. Get out of sin. If that's the issue, you're right. I'm not trying to preach you out from under conviction of living in sin. No, I'm not. But if you're doing what you can, you're reading the Bible, you're seeking God, you're running after Him, you're worshiping Him, and everything has gone wrong, then you need to know that you may try to feel like poor me or feel so down and disheartened, but I would encourage you today to stand up on your feet. Start putting on the armor of God. I want to read that. What's the whole armor of God? Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. That's in Ephesians 6 and 13. I'm going to verse 14. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. I'm telling you, some of you let your shield fall down because you've been discouraged. But lift up the shield of faith and believe that your God will take you through this battle.
He will.
Take this word of God and use it against him.
Amen.
I rebuke you, devil. If you're not strong enough to rebuke him because you're so weak and sick, or you're so weak and sick in heart, then start singing. Start singing something. Start playing our music. Start playing something that's got victory until the devil has to flee. Because I'll tell you what, the enemy wants to take back all the property he's lost through this ministry, but he can't do it.
No. Right.
Not in my mind. He tried that last week, and he may try it next week. But I'll tell you what, friend, I'm not going to lay down to the devil anymore in the name of Jesus. Amen. He doesn't have this property, nor will he ever in the name of Jesus. I'm going to put on my armor of God. I'm going to stand and fight. Because let me tell you, up in heaven, or up in the principalities and up in the places that have spiritual darkness and high places and wickedness, that's going on, that fight.
Yes, it is.
It's not neutral anymore.
Go ahead. Thank God.
We've had some fights. We've had some ministries. We've had some places we've ministered. Nursing homes and jails and in this little church. We've done that. But it's been a little neutral where it hadn't just gone forth like the Lord wanted it to maybe yet. But it's not neutral anymore.
Go ahead.
And so get ready. If you're going to take a stand, the enemy is going to attack.
Right.
And when he attacks, he doesn't play fair, Lainey. He comes in insidious ways, and you don't even really know for sure, was that my mind that thought that? Or he'll say it through somebody you have great faith in or trust, and you think, well, if they said that, then maybe I'm really, well, and then the enemy just comes in like a flood. And you know what? If you're not sinning, get up. Rise up. Put some armor on. Help them fight. Help us fight.
Amen.
Right?
Right.
I didn't mean to preach, Sister Linda.
Keep going.
All right, so when I picked up this Bible, it was on the air conditioner. Picked up this Bible. And I haven't looked at this Bible, but in here is this note. And anybody that knows, my daddy was a note writer, Brother Michael. So he's sending something to you. He sent it to us. 2 Chronicles 7, verse 14. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray, and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, and will forgive their sin, and will heal their land.
Woo! Glory!
I don't know about you, but that sounds like a principality that he's going to take for us.
Yes, glory
to God. I don't know about you, but I feel like that he's going to heal some land. He's going to forgive some sin.
Yes.
He's going to give us victory to walk over this next time instead of getting trapped by it. He's going to pull us up out of that trap and say, walk on, put your armor on and keep walking, because I need you to be a light to this dark world instead of sitting in the mully grubs wondering if you're even saved. That's a lie from the devil.
Yes.
You are saved. You can be sanctified. You can be filled with the Holy Ghost, and it's imperative that it happens in this dark day. Because you're not going to be strong enough to fight him if you just lay down over and over.
Amen.
And I'm preaching to me too.
Go ahead. Help us. Preach it.
Then it says, my daddy told me what to do today. Open 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 1 through 10. Actually, it says open 2 Peter chapter 5, verse 10. And he always did that because he'd look at what was on the top of his page and he'd take what it said. And usually it was the chapter before that. So when I looked for chapter 5 in 2 Peter, there is no chapter 5. And I was like, Daddy, you did it again. I love it. But anyway, verse 1 through 10. And I read that this morning, but I want to read what I feel like the Lord has. Verse 6, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. Whom resist,
yes,
steadfast in the faith,
amen,
knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. But the God of all grace, who hath called you unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus. I'm going to read that again. But the God of all grace, who hath called you unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus. I got to read it again. But the God of all grace, who hath called you unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus.
Yes.
After that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect. Establish, strengthen, settle you. He's going to establish, strengthen, and settle you. But before that, we're going to suffer a little while. But I think what we need to start doing is looking at the way to suffer.
Go ahead.
Sometimes we suffer and we feel like we implode. We go into ourselves, or we mourn, or we feel inadequate, or we feel depressed, or we feel hopeless. That's happened. It's happened to me. Happened to me last week. Had to pray through it. Could have happened to me last night. Had to pray through it. But after that ye have suffered a while, I want to tell you there's a different way to suffer. And people have asked, why on earth would you have a stomach illness that would cause you to throw up probably every day and make you nauseous maybe 18 hours a day sometimes, maybe 20? Why would the Lord allow that? And I can't answer that completely, but I can tell you this. After I've suffered a little while, he's going to make me perfect. He's going to establish me, strengthen me, and settle me.
Oh, yes.
And he's going to teach me how to suffer. Sometimes you got to learn how to suffer. Instead of imploding, maybe it's time that we start exploding. Maybe it's time that we start putting on some armor, putting on our helmet of salvation, stop listening to what the devil's putting in our mind, lifting up our shield of faith so we can quench those fiery darts that are coming and saying, you're inadequate, you can't do anything, you're not really saved, you're going to die from COVID, you're not ever going to be any different, you can't forgive them anyway. He's going to not be able to say those because you've got armor on and you're going to resist it.
Right. Amen.
It's time for us to start suffering a different way. And realize this. He said, after that ye have suffered a while. Now, I don't know how long a while is. Daniel suffered maybe a lot in that book of Daniel, but that day, that time, he had suffered 21 days because the enemy was fighting in the heavens, so he couldn't get that message. So I just say this. I don't know what a while is for you. I don't know what it is for me. But I'm not going to give up. I'm not going to lay down. And I'm going to humble myself. I'm going to pray. I'm going to seek God's face. I'm going to turn from any wicked ways. Because the Lord promised me that he's going to hear from heaven. He's going to forgive sin. And he's going to heal our land. And I'll say this. When our ministry started going out over this internet, it became ours. Wherever you live, right? It is. It's our land, our church, our Highland City Refuge Church of God.
Yes.
Went forth all over the planet.
Yes,
it went to China. If I were to ask my children, there's countries listed that we are in, that people are seeing this. So let me tell you, everywhere you're standing, that is God's. If you're trying to serve the Lord, that's God's property.
It is.
I don't care if you're in a communist country or you can't even worship out loud. It's God's. And the enemy's going to fight for that territory.
Right.
But he's a liar. And it's time for us to put on some armor and start helping the forces that are going on fighting for this to go forth. Let's fight. Let's be encouraged that we've got our armor on.
I don't know. I hadn't been in the military. I'm sure that's pretty obvious. But those of you who have been in the military, I would say that even if you felt like you had a sore throat, when that, it's a bugle, went off in the morning, you had to get up and do what you're supposed to do. Fall in line, get dressed, make sure your bunk was ready. You had to do whatever they told you to do. And we are soldiers in this army, not allowing this line that the Lord has given us a victory to be taken back. You know, keep on the firing line. Get up there and stand. Even if you've got to lay there in the bed and suffer through COVID, know this, that God is a deliverer. He will not allow the enemy to destroy you. He won't. Now, the truth of this is if we end up going home in any of this, if I get in a car wreck on the way out, I'm going home. So any way it goes, if the Lord takes you home through some illness, you're home forever. So that may be the way the Lord allows it. I don't know how the Lord may take some of us home. But I'll tell you this, that until I go, I'm going to rise up and I'm going to keep kicking and scrapping and fighting and trying not to be a brat and trying to have victory and trying to get down and pray and try to remember that the people, the forces and the things that are going on in the sky, we may not can see, but they're fighting for us. I'm not going to let them down.
Go ahead.
I imagine somebody said to me that it's probably my daddy up there fighting with them. And I'm telling you what.
He would.
If they let, if God let him be up there fighting the devil for us down here to go forth more and more, for more of you to get saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, for more of you to come out from the world and be separate, for more of you to start ministering to the places you can minister where we cannot, for more of you to be willing to rise up in this dark day and say, I will not give place to the devil in my heart, in my mind, in my life, in my family, in my ways that I'm able to affect. The devil is not going to have place.
Right.
So, if that is what the enemy's fighting, realize you want to fight back. And the Lord gave us weapons to do it with. But how humbling to think about that the very God that made the universe, that holds our breath in his hands, is fighting for you. For you. Not just for Sister Linda. He's fighting for Sister Linda. But he's fighting for you. If you're not saved today, if you haven't asked Jesus to forgive you, or if you were saved and you've walked away, and you know that the enemy has taken back ground or has never lost the ground of your heart, it's time to come home to Jesus Christ. It's time to be delivered from the enemy that has wanted to destroy your soul, because he will. Let me go back to that for just a second. It said that the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. He's walking around for you, Gloria. The devil is like or as a big roaring lion, and he's looking for you, wondering if he could devour you. But you know who you have access to? You have access to the Lion of the tribe of Judah. You don't have to have this lion that is as a roaring lion. No. You have the very Lion of the tribe of Judah who gave victory to overcome the world. And so I ask you today, if you're not saved, the devil is seeking for you. He's walking around seeing if he can devour you. In your mind, in your heart, in your life, he's going to try to destroy you. But today, I'm giving you an invitation to come and be under the protection of a lion that's never failed. The lion that has strong power over the devil. And I ask you that if you've got sin in your life, or you've got problems you can't see past and they've discouraged you to sit down, I ask you to repent. Come to Jesus today and ask Him to wash your sins away. He took stripes on His back. He was beaten and nailed to a cross. It's for you. If I knew every one of your names that are out there, if I could tell every single person's first, middle, last name, if I could look at you and point to you and say, Lee, Stuart, Greer, Turner, I could say that just that precisely. If I could and say, come to Jesus right now, I would, but I cannot. But the God of all eternity that created everything is reaching out to you right now and saying, come home to Jesus Christ and serve Him with everything that's within you. Because the devil will destroy you if you don't. And you'll go to his place that he's going to be sent to, which is a place of eternal damnation, where there is fire, where there's eternal torment. Hell is real, and it is waiting for you, friend, if you're not willing to repent. But Jesus Christ sent me today with three little scriptures and a thought of that the Holy Ghost gave me last night, not thinking that I was going to bring all this, but He sent me today to say, you can repent. You can join the fight. You can get on the firing line. You can put on the armor of God. You can have somebody to walk beside you when you're all alone. Even if you feel all alone, you'll always know that the Word of God can be picked up and read and held to it, because this is Jesus Christ, the Word of God. If you're in your 21 days and you're saved and you don't know how to get up out of it, pick up the Word of God. Play some songs of victory. Keep going on. If you're not saved today, I'm going to pray, and I want you to pray with me. If you're here in this building, I want you to come down to the altar or go by your seat and talk to Jesus Christ. He gave up all for you. Everything. 33 years old, gave up everything that he had on this planet and everything he had in heaven to come here. Jesus, we come to you. I don't know who's hearing me, but you know them inside and out. Every thought, every word, everything that they've ever done from when they were in their mama's womb. And you have loved them with an everlasting love. And you have drawn them to this service, this day, this minute, to make a decision to love you. Jesus Christ, we call on you for forgiveness and repentance. Let your blood cover him. Ask Jesus to wash your sins away in his blood. He'll do it. Oh, let the blood be applied to their souls. Let their sanctifying work of Jesus Christ go forth. Let the Holy Ghost go and live and dwell and be the comforter and fill our church and fill the countless many that are watching or listening. Let the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost go forth and be real.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' name, if you're not saved, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Jesus, we
telling you right now, you've done too much. You've sinned too greatly. He's lying to you because he wants you to stay his. But it's time for you to get up and come to Jesus and know that the Lion of the tribe of Judah, that the one that's fighting up in the heavens for you, will rescue you out of sin and darkness, out of every sin you've committed. No sin other than blaspheming the Holy Ghost is too great to be repented of. And most people probably don't even know that they know how to do that. So the enemy may try to say that's what you've done. But friend, if he's drawing you under the sound of my voice right now, you've not gone too far. No, he's craving your soul, your friendship, your relationship with him. He's calling you, calling, oh sinner, come home. If you're discouraged this morning, come home. Lay that discouragement, lay it at Jesus' feet and say, Lord, this depression, this discouragement, this overwhelmed feeling, I'm going to lay it at your feet, Jesus. And I will walk on with you, for you're so precious. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling. Calling, oh sinner, come on.
Grace, he will forgive. He's full of tender mercy.
mercy, forgiveness, and care. He will forgive you. Oh, but there is forgiveness with thee that thou mayest be feared. Psalm 130 says, out of the depths have I cried unto thee, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let thine ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication. If thou, Lord, shouldest mark iniquities, O Lord, where should I stay? Who should stand? But there is forgiveness with thee that thou mayest be feared. I will wait for the Lord. My soul doth wait, and in his word do I hope. My soul waiteth for the Lord more than they that watch for the morning. I say more than they that watch for the morning. He's going to redeem us from all our iniquities. In the name of Jesus.
pardon this morning.
Come home.
Full pardon.
Come home.
Praise the Lord. Come on, Clayton. Come on, Gloria. We're going to we miss Nehemiah and Imani, but they can do the job, can't you, honey?
Love each other. And love each other.
Amen.
Praise God.
See you tonight.